And how do most oral histories or folk tales start?
Once upon a time.
Long, long ago.
Like every year, the first major event on our calendar was Indonesian Independence Day.
In the days of Bung Karno, Jakarta was a very different place. There were no tall skyscrapers, apartment blocks, or big hotels. No SeaWorld or Taman Mini. The streets were quiet. Children went to school by becak or andong. Kaki Lima sold sayur, korang, es lilin, satay, and nasi goreng. And the children would listen to the ting, ting, ting of the candy man. This was the new Indonesia, full of hope and excitement for the future. With this came people from around the world. At that time, there were two kinds of schools, Indonesian schools and Dutch schools. But the newcomers needed a school of their own, a school where they could learn in English. And so it all started on Jalan Kaban Siri.
After independence, the UN began to use the house at Kaban Siri as a residence for their missionaries. Freshly evacuated from Mao's New China, Joseph and Antoinette Stepanek moved in with their three children. The boys needed schooling, and Antoinette wasted no time. So Joe and Jim were GIST student number 1 and 2.
We did start in our house, which was the back apartment. And in the morning, we would push the furniture aside, and I have faint recollections of doing that. Now, whether we did that for a week or a month, I can't honestly say.
But I do distinctly remember that the class was also in our bedroom. I remember waking up late one morning and through the mosquito net, I could see that the class was already in session. And I had the embarrassing task of, you know, crawling out of bed.
But it wasn't very long before Harsha Rao arrived. And you know that Harsha was the number 3 boy on that list. It was an end to being a family and very rapidly became a sort of group in which you knew all of the kids. We knew their parents, of course. And then children whose parents we honestly didn't know or work with, it just expanded of its own free will.
Mom's famous garages are as vivid in my mind now, despite all the absence of years.
It was an open-sided shed with, I think, 3 rooms. And each of those stalls was a class.
I can feel the heat. I can see the dirt, a wire mesh on the wall. Very hard benches, and I tell you quite frankly, our little class was not all that well behaved.
Even then, it began as a real school. I mean, as soon as it went out of the living room, and there was a critical mass of kids, it became a real school. And I remember the desks being in rows, in orderly rows, and being called on just like a regular school. I remember the artwork, you know, hanging from every imaginable surface in the room, so it just looked like a first grade classroom today, probably no different at all.
But then the idea of furniture, of course, arose at once. And right away we learned that it was all made in the jail. They were delivered by an open-backed truck, the convicts of the jail, and 1 or 2 guards armed.
That really stands out. When the guard shows up with a gun, inevitably the young child feels like, uh-oh, he's here for me. When in fact the prison guards are bringing the furniture and particularly this amazing gym.
We wanted a schoolyard equipment, and those drawings were left at the jail, and whether the measurements were in the wrong figures or what, but they were all to giant scale when they came, made entirely of teak. It was elegant and beautiful, but as heavy as could be.
We had, in retrospect, the most wonderful teacher, Mrs. Bowden. She was reading us the classics to a third grade in her Javanese batik, you know, beautifully dressed, very stern, very straight. And I remember enough of it to now, you know, appreciate the fact that she was trying to do the nearly impossible.
Mrs. Bowdoin was very serious about the fact that she was educated and that she knew how to teach. She was always the top teacher. Ruth Bogock was an American girl, an artist, who had worked for Disney. She was an animator, and she had drawn Snow White. As a colony, no one came there as an ambassador. They went to Holland. Then, with independence, every country in the world sort of scrambled on the bandwagon to have an embassy placed in Jakarta as early as possible. And people arrived, you might say, almost daily. It was a very exciting time.
You can't express today the optimism. We were privileged to see the beginning of an entirely new government, step by step. As Sukarno appointed his ministers, they in turn recruited staff, and we were asked to help with the training and education of this new government.
The idea of the UN, the flag, you know, the young nations, independence, it's one of those things that we were just raised on, so we didn't really think about it. That the school really had deep roots in the very first days of independence. And it was an English medium, and it served the international community and the United Nations community, and it was a source of great pride to everybody involved.